Services on the screen in a large bold print is your opportunity to participate in the prayers and make them your own. Blessed be God, Father, Son, and Holy Spirit.
Blessed be God's kingdom, now and forever.
From the Gospel of Luke today we will hear these words. Worship the Lord your God and serve only him. The Lord be with you. So we pray together. Gracious God, out of your love and mercy, you created us to serve you and one another. Call forth our paintings and acts of love, and strengthen us to face our mortality, so that we may look with confidence for your salvation and worship you in spirit and truth. Through Christ our Lord. Amen. Save your people, God of truth and mercy, from the chaos of divided loyalties and the worship of many gods.
Save us, God of truth and mercy,
from making you in our own likeness and the slavery of self-centeredness.
Save us, God of truth and mercy,
from using your name trivially and claiming you for our prejudices.
Save us, God of truth and mercy.
From neglecting sabbatical quiet times and being obsessed with busyness.
Save us, God of truth and mercy.
From ignoring or despising the elderly and overindulging the new generation.
Save us, God of truth and mercy.
from glorifying armaments and war and wishing our enemies dead.
Save us, God, truth and mercy.
From watering down love and marriage and the exploitation of sex.
Save us, God, truth and mercy.
From illegal robberies of the stock exchange and the cunning thefts of tax evasion.
Save us, God, truth and mercy.
From TV programs that twist the facts and cruel gossip in supermarkets.
Save us, God, truth and mercy.
From those who preach greed as a virtue and possession lust which is never satisfied.
Jesus Christ, Saviour of all who lose their way, healing Spirit, power that renews the world, Creator Father, save us, God of truth and mercy.
May God, who loved the world so much that he sent his Son to be our Saviour, forgive you your sins and make you holy to serve him in the world through Jesus Christ our Lord.
Amen. Amen.
O saving God, who led your people through the wilderness and brought them to the promised land, so guide us that, following our Saviour, we may walk through the wilderness of this world and be brought to the glory of the world which is to come. Through your Son, Jesus Christ, our Lord, who lives and reigns with you in the Holy Spirit, one God, for ever and ever.
Amen.
Amen. So let's listen to Scripture.
A reading from the letter to the Romans, chapter 10, beginning with verse 4. For Christ is the end of the law, so that there may be righteousness for everyone who believes. Moses writes concerning the righteousness that comes from the law, that the person who does these things will live by them. But the righteousness that comes from faith says, do not say in your heart, who will descend into heaven, that is, to bring Christ down, or who will descend into the abyss, that is, to bring Christ up from the dead. But what does it say? The word is near you, on your lips and in your heart. That is the word of faith that we proclaim. Because if you confess with your lips that Jesus is Lord and believe in your heart that God raised him from the dead, you will be saved. For one believes with the heart and so is justified, and one confesses with the mouth and so is saved. The scripture says, no one who believes in him will be put to shame. For there is no distinction between Jew and Greek. The same Lord is Lord of all, and is generous to all who call on him. For everyone who calls on the name of the Lord shall be saved. Hear the word of the Lord.
Thanks be to God.
The Gospel of our Lord Jesus Christ, according to Luke chapter 4, beginning at verse 1.
Glory to you, Lord Jesus Christ.
Jesus, full of the Holy Spirit, returned from the Jordan and was led by the Spirit into the wilderness, where for 40 days he was tempted by the devil. He ate nothing at all during those days, and when they were over, he was famished. The devil said to him, if you are the Son of God, command this stone to become a loaf of bread. Jesus answered him, it is written, one does not live by bread alone. Then the devil led him up and showed him in an instant all the kingdoms of the world. And the devil said to him, to you I will give their glory and all the authority, for it has been given over to me. And I give it to anyone I please. If you then will worship me, it will all be yours. Jesus answered him, it is written, worship the Lord your God and serve only him. Then the devil took him to Jerusalem and placed him on the pinnacle of the temple, saying to him, if you are the Son of God, throw yourself down from here. said, for it is written, he will command his angels concerning you to protect you. And on their hands they will bear you up, so that you will not dash your foot against a stone. Jesus answered him, it is written, do not put the Lord your God to the test. When the devil had finished every test, he departed from him until an opportune time. Then Jesus, filled with the power of the Spirit, returned to Galilee, and a report about him spread through all the surrounding country. He began to teach in their synagogues and was praised by everyone. For the Gospel of the Lord.
Praise to you, Lord Jesus Christ. Come, Holy Spirit, come and fill the hearts of your people. They might be open to hearing your word. And as we hear it, to act on it. That we might be a light to those around us. That you might draw them to yourself through us. We ask this through Jesus Christ our Lord. Amen. Please be comfortable. The view that I've got up there is probably the view that Jesus may have been looking at when he was in his wilderness experience. And you can almost see in there, around the base of those hills, it looks like a road. And that's actually the road to Jericho. So you can imagine Jesus in the wilderness there, being in a position where he could see people walking along that road to Jericho and coming up with that story about the Samaritan being robbed on the road to Jericho. I just find it interesting, so the idea that in this space, so that's a wadi, that's the creek basically that's running down the bottom there. So in the middle of this sort of wilderness, we ask the question about what does wilderness mean? And the word in scripture actually means the place of being alone, not necessarily being out in a desert or anything like that, but the place of being alone. So here is Jesus, he's driven into the wilderness, or as led into the wilderness, as Luke and Matthew put it. I think Mark uses the word driven, which literally means to throw. He's thrown into the wilderness. Why is he there? Why does he go? When is this taking place within the chronology of the gospel story? Well, it's happening after Jesus' baptism. And so Jesus has this experience in his baptism where he hears this voice speaking to him. In Luke's context, he hears this voice speaking to him, saying, you are my son, the one that I love. I am pleased with you. Now, I don't know about you, but if I heard a voice like that, because I don't hear voices, I don't hear God at all.
It's spooky.
It's spooky. It would be terrifying. And the first thing I'd want to do is to go rushing off and try and work out what this means. What does this mean? I had no sense that my call to ordained ministry was in that kind of way. I read the scriptures and I had a sense that the scriptures were speaking to me about being ordained. No voice. Just that kind of sense. Any when I've had those experiences of God, there've been a sense, no voice. Occasionally I've had a vision, but more, I've never heard God speak. But those times when those things happen, the first thing that you want to do is to go, what does this mean? And so we've got a really human picture of Jesus here, I think. So he's led by the Spirit into the place of being alone to ask those questions. What does it mean? What is going on here? Who am I? What am I supposed to do? And I think we make the mistake sometimes of thinking about these three temptations about being our temptations. And in some sense, that's true, I think, because we are humans and Jesus was human. And as I'll get to shortly, those people who've experienced those temptations before were humans too. How easy it is to fall into those places. So what might be those things that you think about when those temptations come up?
Well, the first temptation really isn't a temptation. If you're hungry, you're going to want to eat. Is there anything wrong with having your needs met? No, God promises to fulfill our needs. When I was a new Christian, and because of the background I had in the church, I was immediately kind of being mentored through youth and children's ministry. And there was one Sunday in the church that I was being nurtured in where I was asked to assist with the Sunday school. And we were exploring these particular questions, and the way that we were doing that was asking the kids, when I say kids, we're not talking about the really tiny kids, we're talking about, you know, primary school kind of age kids, how we might reinterpret those questions in a modern way. And I can't remember what all of them was except for one. The one that says, you know, if you're hungry, turn these stones into bread. And the way that they reinterpret this story was to Jesus responding with, "You can't live by McDonald's alone." I guess at the time I was really hoping there'd be something really amazing that these kids had come up with. Clearly they didn't. But now as I look back on that, as I've been thinking about that in preparation for today, I found myself thinking, maybe they were onto something. Maybe they were onto kind of that instant available stuff. I know that when I was doing my road trips to Tamworth to see Mum, I used McDonald's basically as my go-to for meal breaks and for coffee. Because the coffee normally isn't that bad at McDonald's. It's pretty good coffee. Except there was one time, and I think it was because they hadn't cleaned the machine properly. But that was my go-to, and you know, often I would try out the new kind of hamburger that they were offering, that kind of stuff, that sort of thing, you know. Anyway, and I would eat, and then of course I'd feel unsatisfied afterwards. Do you find that with those sorts of fast food things? Just kind of regret it, really. And so there's that kind of sense, maybe they were touching on something about how this kind of instant thing, this instant availability that we've got, that is then unsatisfying. And I thought, maybe they were onto something. But there's something else going on in all of this. I'm not quite sure that I have a need, in some sense, to try and reinterpret these things or have an understanding of these things in a way which is going to make sense in our modern context. Because there are things that connect with others in this story. So Jesus is 40 days in the wilderness. What is something that comes to mind about the people of God previously?
40 years
in the wilderness. Exactly. Now I'm beginning to wonder whether a way that we can understand these is the relationship between that experience of the 40 years in the wilderness and Jesus' experience and what it says about who Jesus is and what he's supposed to be doing. So there are three problems that took place within that 40 years in the wilderness. One was they started to moan because they had nothing to eat. They weren't willing to listen to God. God gave them firstly manna, then they got sick and tired of the manna, and so then he gave them birds to eat, so they had meat to eat. So there was that first one that was what went on. And then you've got that picture of them, sort of when Moses was up the mountain receiving the Ten Commandments, what was going on down below? You nearly... They made the golden calf. So they were looking for someone, they were looking for another god to lead them back to Egypt, basically. So they made the golden calf and they were worshipping that. That's when they came down.
They were looking for a way out.
So that's the day that Moses broke all the Ten Commandments at once, because he smashed the tablets that they were written on. There's another joke for you, you can laugh about that one later. So you've got that worship stuff that was going on there. And then you've got that picture, well, one of the pictures, through the entire time of Israel in the wilderness, they were constantly putting God to the test. We've got that clear picture by the waters of Meribah, where they were thirsty. give us some water. And Moses said to them something along the lines of, why are you complaining about this? Why are you putting God to the test? Now, God gave them the water. But here was this example of them the entire time putting God to the test. Kind of prove yourself. Prove yourself. So we've got these three temptations that Jesus goes through, which were the experience of the Israelites in the wilderness. And yet Jesus does not fail in the temptations that were there. So he does not fall into the trap of the idea of food. You can only live by the word of God. You do not put God to the test. You shall worship the Lord your God only. So what we've got here, I think, is this comparison between Israel that was, that is, if you like, and Jesus, who is now coming in and proclaiming, who will begin proclaiming this particular message, is a comparison of the two. Israel failed. Jesus doesn't. So what does it say about Jesus? What's he discovering through all of this? What are we discovering about Jesus? The question here is, what does this tell us about who Jesus is and what he's supposed to do? And the answer is, I think, it's showing us that Jesus is the way Israel is meant to be. What Jesus is going to proclaim is what Israel was meant to be. And if you go back to what Israel was meant to be, does anyone have any idea what that's like? Go back to Abraham and the call of Abraham. Genesis 12. Here is that picture where God speaks to Abraham. Just the word of God speaks to Abraham and says, go from your father's house to the land that I will give you, and I'll make you into a great nation. And what does he do? He gets up and goes. There is none of this kind of sense of anything but purely about being in relationship with God. And God says to Abraham, through that people that I will create is the purpose for you to be blessed to be a blessing. It's one of those key phrases that sort of forms my spirituality. Blessed to be a blessing. That's how it was supposed to be. And so Jesus comes out of that wilderness experience, that time of being alone, some kind of sense, obviously, about what he's being called to. And he begins, apart from you've got the genealogy that Paul puts in there, which is different to Matthew's genealogy, he goes in and starts teaching in the synagogues. And people are beginning to respect what he's saying. But the thing that he actually quotes in the first recorded sermon we've got of him in the synagogue, he's quoting from Isaiah, which is a passage which is describing what Israel's supposed to be. Now,
I want to quote this properly, so I'm going to read it to you if I can find it very, very quickly in my notes. I found it. How about that?
So what he says is this: the Spirit of the Lord is upon me because he is anointed to bring good news to the poor. He has sent me to proclaim the release to the captives and recovery of sight to the blind, and let the oppressed go free, to proclaim the year of the Lord's favour. This is what Israel is supposed to be like. It's the first recorded sermon we've got that Jesus gives. Here is a picture of what we're supposed to take away from this wilderness experience of Jesus. This, and as disciples of Jesus, we are, if you like, the new Israel. We are to be those that Israel has got lost somewhere along the line. We are to be God's people, blessed to be a blessing, in the simplest form of understanding of what that means, that Jesus made possible for us just to have a relationship with God. That's who we're supposed to be. Now, the reality is that we're all human, and this story, This account that we've got in here gives us a very human picture of Jesus, in the sense that, you know, we talk about him, obviously we talk about him being a God incarnate, and that's true. But there's a sense where there's a purely human Jesus that's revealed here. That kind of sense that Jesus doesn't know what God is doing. It's kind of left that knowledge behind in heaven. somehow, if you can put it that way, at this, he is fully human, not part human and part God. He's fully human. And so he has this experience which is asking the question about, well, what does this mean? And so we are invited into that journey with him, asking the question, what is it that we need to do? What is it that we need to be? This story reminds us that we are to be the new Israel, as Israel was meant to be. The Lord be with you.
And also with you.
So why don't you stand with me as we together declare our faith in Jesus Christ. Though he was divine, he did not cling to equality with God, but made himself nothing, taking the form of a slave. He was born in human likeness, he humbled himself, and was obedient to death, even the death of the cross. Therefore God has raised him on high, and given him the name above every name, that at the name of Jesus every knee should bow, and every voice proclaim that Jesus Christ is Lord, to the glory of God the Father. Amen. Today is God, in whom we trust and hope. Save us when we call on you. God, in whom we trust and hope, hear the prayers for the world and for the church. Hear us and answer us. Long ago you brought your people out of slavery to freedom. We bring before you the Ukraine and all places that are in conflict at this time. Hear the cries of your people today who are held in the bondage of oppression, persecution, or war. God, in whom we trust and hope, save us when we call on you. You led your people through a desert to a land flowing with milk and honey. We pray for South Sudan and all places where you need to hear the cries of your people today who are hungry and homeless, or for whom daily life is a struggle for survival. God, in whom we trust and hope, save us when we call on you. With a mighty hand and outstretched arm, you led your people out of Israel. As we think about our community and all those who are in it, hear the cries of those today who have lost their way, all who wander without direction, all who are without purpose or hope in their lives. God, in whom we trust and hope, save us when we call on you. With arms outstretched upon a cross, you brought redemption to your people. I bring before you all those who are living in broken relationships. Hear the cries of those today who long to hear your message of forgiveness, reconciliation, and love. God, in whom we trust and hope, save us when we call on you. You led your son out into a desert to prepare for his earthly ministry. We bring before you our need to hear your voice calling to us of what we are to do. And so we pray that you will hear the prayers for all who seek this Lent to understand the meaning of their baptism and equip them to carry your gospel to our broken world. God, in whom we trust and hope, save us when we call on you. You send your angels to minister to your son in the desert. Hear the cries of those today who experience pain, loneliness, despair or grief. All who are sick, all who are in need of your tenderness and care, and all who care for them. God, in whom we trust and hope, save us when we call on you. You led your chosen people from a place of slavery into the land of their inheritance. Remember those who have died in the faith and come into the inheritance you promised to all who love you. Strengthen us to turn away from that which takes away the fullness of life, and guide us safely through that wilderness where we are confronted with our sin and faced with our death, that with your pilgrim people of every age, we may enter the promise of your eternal kingdom. God, in whom we trust and hope, save us when we call on you. God, in whom we trust and hope, accept our prayers through Jesus Christ, our Saviour, who taught us to pray. Our Father in heaven, hallowed be your name. Your kingdom come, your will be done on earth as in heaven. Give us today our daily bread. Forgive us our sins, as we forgive those who sin against us. Save us from the time of trial, and deliver us from evil. For the kingdom, the power, and the glory are yours, now and forever. Amen. Would you stand with me? if you are able. Being justified by faith, we have peace with God through our Lord Jesus Christ. The peace of the Lord be always with you.
And also with you.
May the Holy Spirit be upon us now to cleanse our hearts, hallow our gifts, and perfect the offering of ourselves for the love of Jesus Christ our Lord.
Blessed be God forever.
The Lord be with you.
And also with you.
Lift up your hearts.
We lift them to the Lord.
Let us give thanks to the Lord our God.
It is right to give our thanks and praise.
For glory and honour be yours always and everywhere, mighty Creator, ever living God. We give you thanks and praise for your Son, our Saviour Jesus Christ, who by the power of your Spirit was born of Mary and lived as one of us. He was tempted in every way as we are, yet he did not sin. By his death on the cross and rising to new life, he offered the one true sacrifice for sin and obtained an eternal deliverance for his people. By his grace, we are able to triumph over every evil and to walk in the way of his love. Therefore, with angels and archangels and with all the company of heaven, we proclaim your great and glorious name, for praising you and saying,
Holy, holy, holy Lord, God of power and might, heaven and earth are full of your glory. Hosanna in the highest. Blessed is he who comes in the name of the Lord. Hosanna in the highest.
Merciful God, we thank you for these gifts of your creation, this bread and wine. We pray that by your word and Holy Spirit, we who eat and drink them and partakers of Christ's body and blood. On the night he was betrayed, Jesus took bread. And when he had given you thanks, he broke it and gave it to his disciples, saying, Take, eat, this is my body given for you. Do this in remembrance of me. After supper, he took the cup, and again giving you thanks, he gave it to his disciples, saying, Drink from this, all of you. This is my blood of the new covenant, shed for you and for many for the forgiveness of sins. Do this as often as you drink it, in remembrance of me. Gracious God, you have gathered us together to feed on Christ and to remember everything he has done.
We recall the death of your Son, Jesus Christ. We proclaim his resurrection and ascension, and look with expectation for his coming again.
Renew us by your Holy Spirit. Unite us in the body of your Son, and bring us with all your people into the joy of your eternal kingdom through Jesus Christ our Lord, with whom and in whom, in the fellowship of the Holy Spirit, we worship you, Father, in songs of never-ending praise.
Blessing and honor, glory and power are yours forever and ever. Amen.
As this broken bread was once many grains, which have been gathered together and made one bread,
so may your church be gathered from the ends of the earth into your kingdom.
Jesus is the Lamb of God who takes away the sins of the world. Happy are those who are called to his supper.
Lord, I am not worthy to receive you, but only say the word, and I shall be healed.
So come, let us take this holy sacrament of the body and blood of Christ in remembrance that he lived, died, and rose again for us, and feed on him in our hearts by faith with thanksgiving. Worship the Lord your God and serve only him. Lord God, you feed us with the living bread from heaven. Renew our faith, increase our hope, and strengthen our love. Teach us to hunger for Christ, who is the true and living bread, and to live by every word that comes from your mouth, through Jesus Christ our Lord. Father, we offer ourselves to you as a living sacrifice, through Jesus Christ our Lord. Send us out in the power of your Spirit to live and work to your praise and glory. Amen. Just a reminder that we're having our Lenten study online on Wednesdays at 7 o'clock. And I'll send that link out again today when I put the service online and notify you that it's online. So also there's the place if you want to access the e-book that's available for you to follow and do advanced reading if you want to. So. Is there anything else we need to know?
Men's breakfast.
Men's breakfast is on Saturday.
Saturday at
8:30. Very good. I'm having friends over for barbecue lunch on Saturday, so that'll be lots of food that day. Invite you to stand for the blessing. Christ our Saviour, draw you to himself, that you may find in him crucified a sure ground for faith, a firm support for hope, and indeed the assurance of sin forgiven. And the blessing of God Almighty, the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit be with you and those whom you love this day and forevermore. Amen. Let's go in peace to love and serve the Lord.
In the name of Christ. Amen.
Thank you. pure.